today's global arena, managing remote teams requires a new type of leadership. In the words of our next guest on leading work from home teams, people are people and time is time. Today, Wednesday, May the 6th, 2020, we bring you Chris Redmond, a self-proclaimed digital nomad and founder of Redholt, an executive search agency. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm thrilled to be joined by Chris Redmond from Redholt. So Chris is the managing partner over at Redholt, a search and advocacy service focused on technology, digital marketing and sales globally. Chris, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much, Colin. Pleasure to be with you.
We find ourselves living in interesting times, as the Chinese proverb says, right? It's like, what with the COVID-19 issues that we're seeing around the globe and that we're all having to live with. As a search and advocacy agency, what are you doing? It's like, I know, you know, I guess that's a bit of a leading question because I know a little bit about Redholt, right? And, you know, you really are a true example of the digital nomad. Yeah, but what are you doing that's different over at Redholt that you know, is helping you get through some of the current issues that we're seeing out there in the marketplace?
Yeah, highly relevant question, I think, Colin. At the moment, we are lucky to be ahead of the curve, and I say that with a distinct undercurrent of being humble, because it's a forced change rather than one that most people have decided on. However, we did decide to become what we call digital nomads in 2020. And so therefore we were preparing ourselves in December last year. And to answer your question in practical terms, the traction on that concept means that we've based everything in the cloud. Our entire business is cloud-based. We have trained our people up before we left our office. We physically left the shared office space that we had in December. And from about August or September, we were training the guys up by doing 1 or 2 days a week working from home, and then being back together and feathering in some of the types of dynamics that it's really hard to anticipate, especially with younger people in your business. Some of the dynamics that affect the day-to-day of how you feel, how you operate, optimizing your outcomes, how you measure metrics when you're not all, you know, in line of sight of a board where you write up everything that you're doing. You know, these are the things that I think a lot of businesses now, Colin, are really going to be struggling with. It's the practicalities of what it means to every individual, and we're all different, every minute, every hour of every day, of every week, of every month now in the context that we're in.
So this is something you've been doing since December.
Well, actually, you know what? For me, Colin, I mean, I've been working in international leadership roles since my mid-20s. So I'm actually more used to...
So last week then, right?
Yeah, exactly. Thanks, Colin. I'm looking good on it.
You are looking good. So, you haven't got the wrinkles like me, mate. Look, this one goes the wrong way, but we won't go into that.
In real terms, for the last 20 years, I've been running teams where I don't have a line of sight on that. Right. And actually, in matrix organizations, this is a really important thing. When you don't have a direct line hierarchy of people, I think that you have to develop a gravity as a leader where you earn the right to lead people. And I think that's particularly important as well, working as digital nomads or working from home, as people more conventionally refer to it, because if you don't have that magnetic draw on the people who you need to influence to work properly, then it can become like a bit of a war of the worlds, at least initially, where people want to do what they want to do. You want to hope that they're doing what you want them to do. Yep. And it's really hard to gauge. And I think what you get at the negative end of the spectrum is an erosion of trust. And that's not a good thing in any workplace.
But it also comes down to trust in the first instance, right? I mean, I think that's why a lot of organizations have historically haven't had a work from home policy, because there is that lack of trust in the associates from, you know, the management team, etc. Is that what you see and you feel?
Well, you know, when I came into the recruitment sector, one of the things that struck me within the first few weeks was that I, unfortunately, being very transparent, I think the recruitment sector and many people who own recruitment businesses and who are managers in recruitment businesses have got an inbred paranoia. You know, if I can't see my people, what are they doing? They're bound to be speaking to my competitors or not doing what I want them to be doing, basically. And that was kind of alien to me because, as I had said, I'd always done roles where my team were spread globally. So I inherently was built with a trust default. But yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, if you don't have that, that's the foundation of everything else. If you're building anything else without trust, it's a shaky foundation.
But if you look at your career, Chris, it hasn't always been in recruitment, right? It's like, you know, if you go back to when you were that 20-year-old, you were working for Colt back then, right?
Correct. Yeah, 26, I was lucky enough to be offered a job as the head of the post-sales professional services practice for a £1.6 billion telecoms company with 38,000 kilometres of fibre and 18 data centres all around Europe, owned by Fidelity Investments. So at a tender young age, I was really exposed to the accountability of leadership in a big, not global, but, you know, pan-European organisation. And it taught me a hell of a lot really quickly.
So just picking up on that, it's like, what lessons do you feel you've learned from the global economy that you could bring to today's uncertainty to help, you know, lead those teams and give that visibility through the, do you know what, guys, it's okay. There isn't a playbook for this one. We haven't seen this really before, but, you know, we lived through 2009. It's like, you know, we had, you know, various other crashes, like, throughout that tenor of yours. Like, how do you coach your teams? How do you coach your clients on trust us, it's going to be okay?
Yeah, okay. That's a brilliant question, Colin. So I think that the thing for me, there's two constants for me. Mm-hmm. People are people and time is time. Now, I know that sounds really cliche, but the reality is all of us, you know, eat, drink, sleep, enjoy music, you know, all of the things that make us human are the things that normalize us. And I think that when you overcomplicate things, that's when you can start to bend yourself out of shape as an individual. You know, you and I speaking now, we're two blokes just living our lives, hoping that our family are happy and healthy. And most people will be. That's the disarming truth. I think the other thing, and that's important to remember, especially in times of change. And I think it gives you a sense of strength and spine as well around your sense of identity. The second thing is we all only get 24 hours a day and we choose to do what we're going to do with that. Everybody. You know, from Trump to everybody sitting in my business today, that we get our 24 coins and we decide how we're going to choose them once, you know, every rotation of the earth. And I think that's important to remember as well, because if those two things put us all on a level, every single person on earth, then everything else is your choice. You know, you choose what you're going to do. You cut through all of the rest of the complications and the crap that sometimes create a hazy view of what you're trying to achieve and just go, that's the direction I'm going in. That's what I'm going to achieve. So that's what I'm saying to my people at the moment is don't get lost. This is just a momentary mist. Let's keep doing what we're going to do. And in fact, if anything, let's turn the volume up. Let's open the taps on what we do.
So you must have seen this coming. I mean, have you got a crystal ball or something? Because look, when I talked about to the team about creating a podcast series around globalization, I started to think through my Rolodex, who would be a, you know, great person to have on the show. Your name automatically came up, you know, just because of how, you know, active you are on social media. If I look at your Twitter account, for example, and I haven't been stalking you, I promise, but looking just now, yeah, you've got 1,137 followers, right? That's bigger than some of the you know, SMEs that I've dealt with over the last 10 years, right? So you're obviously doing something right because people follow you, right? And the crystal ball comment really comes in because if you look at your last post, right, it talks about the something that you put out there in December, right, that you called the four horsemen of disruption and how to harness the focus of global transformation, right? So did you know this was coming? It's like, you know, how did you get into that? And what is the, you know, what are the four horsemen?
Okay, so, you know, first of all, I wish I'd have seen this coming. I think that The reason that we chose to do that with Accenture as the sponsor and with a marketing company to help us make sure we got the content really crisp is because I think that if you're going to want to take from the market, i.e. market share, you've got to offer something to the market. And that doesn't just mean transactionally pushing your products. For me, it was agnostic of what our products are. Let's demonstrate that we've got intellectual horsepower at Red Hole. Let's demonstrate that we've got enough intellectual horsepower to analyze what might happen and enough good vocabulary to articulate what that might be. So, you know, we canvassed and used Accenture data to go through feedback from 38,000 companies, I think across 32 different countries. And we identified four things that we thought would resonate with companies, either as the four horsemen of disruption, as we decided to call it, or alternatively, things that could be enablers for your business. So, you know, those things, examples of those things are what we call the millennial influence, the way that millennials can make a difference. But if you fail to recognize they want to be different, that's a disruptor. Next one is technology. You know, technology is a really interesting thing when it comes to people being adverse to using it, but once they get their arms around it, it being a distinct enabler. And I think a lot of people are being forced through that pain barrier at the moment, Colin. People who'd never wanted to work from home and never wanted their teams to work from home. No choice, get your arms around the tech now, because if you're going to be successful, if you're going to keep your head above water, you're going to need to. The next one is global economies and the way that domestic economies increasingly have a bigger gravity on neighboring economies. And then the last one was the way that people want to work, you know, people and their inclinations. Even if they're not millennial, things like social media, brilliant example. You know, if people now are not using social media, to me, they're going to have to run just to stand still. If you're going to get ahead of the pack, if you're going to get ahead of the curve, however you want to term it, you're going to need to use social media to your advantage. And it's interesting you talk about Twitter, because I think I've been using Twitter for almost a decade, from when I first started my blog as well, Red Book. And now increasingly every day...
Is that a plug?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, okay. We'll get into plugs in a minute, mate. But no, carry on. Red Book, right? Red Book.
But you know, that's been, I think that's had over 50,000 hits. But now... Wow. It's all on Instagram. I mean, I've got over 3,500 followers personally on Instagram. And every day we use an Instagram television, IGTV, for both Red Holt, as well as my own personal Instagram page. And we've got a real synergy across. Everyone in our business has got access to the Instagram page for Red Holt. And I encourage them all to put their own stories up, because it gives people a real feeling for the organic nature of our business. So
that's how you see social media playing a role in shaping the next chapter of digital marketing and digital sales, right? We talk about social selling, but you know, we're all, whatever we do, we're always selling, right? It's like you know, you doing this blog or this blog with me, or this podcast with me, right? It's like yeah, that's a form of selling, right? We're putting ourselves out there. We're painting the picture of us and our organizations. People buy from people, but it really, social has to be part of that fabric from a sales and marketing perspective going forward. Would you agree?
Couldn't agree more, Colin. And this is the one reason, above all else, why I believe that social media is disarming and powerful at the same time. Never before has there been a media that people can market anything, themselves or their product or their brand, through, that has got such distinct authenticity. And what I mean by that is, with the increasing use of stories and with the unedited, quick pace of how stuff goes out onto a range of social media platforms, you don't get the chance to edit stuff as much as you used to. You get a much more real feeling of the personality of whatever it is that is going out onto that social media. And I think that's a good thing, but you've got to have a good sense of self-identity and an intimacy with what your objectives are to make sure that that content is consistent and consistently good.
But that content, how do you, so the consistently good, right? I guess that's the answer to the question. But you know, the question is, how do you ensure that information that you're putting out there, that content you're putting out there, really resonates with the person that's receiving it and consuming it, and they just don't consider it spam. How do you keep that engagement and discussion going forward, Chris?
For me personally, I always try and make sure that I'm very crisp in the content that I'm offering. Now, that might be something different this hour to what it will be next hour, but I always relate it back to Red Hole and our product offering. So whatever's happening or whatever I might be narrating in terms of my observations of the economy, of certain markets or whatever, I always relate that back to our product set and the value that I hope and think and believe that that offers. And also an openness. I always wrap up most of my posts, whether or not that's on our wall or on our story, by saying, you know, please feel free to contact me. Whenever we do an Instagram IGTV content, I always finish off by putting a banner underneath with my email address and personal phone number. Now on LinkedIn, you know, I've got 8,000 followers on LinkedIn. And even today, this morning, I had someone write to me in response to the video that I put up there, saying, Chris, have you got any ideas on what we can do to keep the momentum in our sales pipeline in a time where people are less inclined than ever to respond to emails?
And what did you say to him?
Similar to what we're talking about now. You know, there's a product called Vidyard. I don't know if you know it.
Yeah, no, Vidyard, very well. Others like Wisteria, Wisteria. Wisteria's a plant growing in my back garden. But Wisteria is another one. You know, there are a number of them, but we know Vidyard very well.
I love it, and I use Vidyard extensively because in 30 seconds I can make a quick clip, I can post the URL that gets generated from Vidyard, send it over to that person, and because when they click on it, it opens it in a Red Hole page, I've also put a link to my calendar underneath. So again, I finish off the Vidyard clip by saying, if you want to talk more about this, click the link below. It'll take you straight to my diary and we can speak to each other at a time that's mutually convenient.
So what you're doing there though, Chris, is you're creating, you've got a technology stack, right? It's like that you're using with inside your business. And historically, we may think of it as single-threaded, right? It's like, do you know what? Email gives me email. It's like, the video shows me the video. If you want to access my calendar, so like, here's my calendar details. What you've done there is brought all three of those together. Yeah, plus I know many more because I know your business quite well.
Yeah, do you know what? I remember working for a guy called John Plutherow at a company called Energis before Colt in my telecoms days. He went on to be the chief exec of Cable and Wireless. But John Plutherow had a fantastic philosophy that has become part of my DNA, which is demystify. You know, be easy to do business with. At that time, technology was full of three-letter acronyms and people were confused into closing deals. What John brought to the table was a philosophy where we became the trusted counsel to our clients and made it easy for them to take the next step. And I guess I've always weaved that into the fabric of my approach personally.
So being someone that is very creative by nature, someone that is very socially engaged and has social media built into the fabric of your organization, what do you say are some of the do's and don'ts for organizations that are looking to build up their social presence, right, or to enhance their social presence?
First of all, I'd say it's important to get everyone on the same page in terms of what you're trying to achieve, because I think if you want to enhance the texture of what you're using in terms of content, you should have more people feeding into it than just one. That will feel very one-dimensional and repetitive by nature. That's why we've given everybody the logins to our Instagram page as Red Hole. Yep. And you get that feeling because everyone's posting stories. I think the next thing is the do's and don'ts. I'd say the do's are have themes. Like, we always have a theme so that no matter who's posting, it will naturally have the accent of their personality on it, but it will have a spine of purpose, if that makes sense. So we'll be talking about a similar thing. The don'ts, that I see this quite a lot, and it's quite cringy, and I think it's a real demonstration of immaturity, although we all have to go through that stage of the life cycle, I get that, is when you've got people where you're aiming to be taken seriously but not putting serious content in. And I don't mean heavy content. I just mean mature, you know, offer value. You know, you can be funny. You can even have your personality. But some of the cartoony type stuff, I think, who are you aiming this content at? You know, it's not going to be guys that have got huge budgets that are going to be looking at this type of content and thinking, wow, I want to do business with these guys. I'd say, yep. you know, your content needs to maintain a certain sense of maturity and gravity and just have a general heartbeat to it in terms of regularity as well.
So two things there, right? One is, you know, what I would say from your first point is it's really credibility, right? And building up the... Your position as an industry thought leader or thought leader or someone that can add value, hence the thought leadership. Yeah. And then the second thing is, if you're going to do this, yeah, don't go into it. It's like, go into it wholeheartedly, right? If you're going to go into it, it's like jump in, dive in. Content is king, the quality and the quantity. So do it regularly. Yeah, and get into, I hate the word cadence, but get into that cadence, right? That you know, it needs to be a rhythm, yeah, and a momentum. Question for you, Chris, is email dead?
Yeah, maybe. You know, I think that, so I kind of see email as a vehicle rather than we used to see email as 100%. For me now, email is just the vehicle that we put the cargo onto. For example, I'd send a vidyard attached to an email.
Yep.
But I'll tell you one thing, I don't listen to voicemail messages anymore. That's dead. If people leave me a voicemail message, chances are I'm not going to listen to it. And I even say that on my voicemail message, please don't leave me a voicemail message. Send me a text or an email.
Yep.
I think email may well be the next one on the extinction list. I think now, and this is a great example, I see people taking screenshots of emails and putting them on WhatsApp. Now, that's interesting.
Yeah.
And even for me, like, you know, I think I'm quite tech savvy, but the average age in my business is 25, 26, and I see them taking a screenshot of an email and then putting that on the WhatsApp chat, because WhatsApp moves at a pace that email just doesn't, you know.
Yeah. So whether it be WhatsApp or whether it be Slack or whether it be Teams, those types of instant communication, yeah, and instant response are things that are really starting to pick up. Right?
And you know what it makes me think as well, Colin? Two blue ticks have started to become obsessively powerful to people. You know, the way that the people in our business now, and increasingly myself, like using WhatsApp because you know when someone has read it.
As long as you don't turn that function off, mate, which I've done.
Yeah.
There is a setting, you know that, right?
There is a setting to turn it off. But you know what? I even noticed that attracts a certain type of commentary as well. Why has he turned it off?
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Never thought of it that way.
Because quite often when we're trying to keep... The signature of our brand is accelerated searches, right?
Yep.
And managing at pace effective communications across a broad spectrum of stakeholders effectively is what we must do. I mean, we have to become masters at doing that. And so therefore, knowing when someone has looked at something and then generally developing an intuition around what the distance between them reading it and responding or doing something about it means is often quite telling for us. When, right. when someone's turned off that facility and we're in the dark, it's a little bit like if we don't have the ability to see what it means,
you're starting to shake.
Yeah, it's kind of like that. And yeah. what do humans do when they don't have an answer? They start to use their imagination.
Or they start to spam you, right? It's like, oh, let me pick up the phone now because he's not responding. Oh, let me send an email.
But I think
you start to go into overdrive, right?
I think, yeah, and I think that type of behaviour and conduct is at least indicative of a generation and probably indicative of a business moment that we're in where the speed of comms determines our proximity to a deal close, which is often what determines what people are being driven to do when they get to their desk every day.
Yep. So question for you. It's like working remotely is likely to become the new norm. What are you seeing as the implications on the various marketing strategies that you're having around getting the brand Red Hole out into the marketplace and keeping your message new and fresh?
I have to admit, I'm loving that challenge. That frontier that we're now at is probably one that, if I could have accelerated it without the tragic circumstances associated to where we are today, I'd have done it 100%, Colin. And the reason is because what I'm finding is that where convention used to make people reticent to engage in collaborative tools such as this, now they're having to do it. I've never seen so frequently and so commonly and at so many levels of society, indiscriminate of everything else, so many moments of clear and distinct compassion between each other as human beings.
Yep.
I know there's a lot of horrible stuff going on, but we do have this common enemy as humans at the moment. And I kind of like the fact that it's disarming some of the tensions that I've always known between people in life. So it's amazing. We're in an amazing moment at the moment.
So, Chris, I said that I'd give you the opportunity to plug Red Hole, right, at the end of it, or even like you yourself. I mean, as I say, I know that you're a social ambassador, social warrior, social engaged general good bloke. How can people find you and how can people follow you?
So I would say I'm remarkably open to all forms of social media. You mentioned my Twitter, ChrisRedmond100 is my Twitter handle. CKRed1 is where I am on Instagram. Redholt Search is where the business is on Instagram. Increasingly LinkedIn and our company page is a great general place to go to follow what's going on. And what you'll see across all of those platforms is that actually I use a lot of the same media, which is because I am who I am and there's no point me using anything different. Facebook as well, loads of people follow me on Facebook, again, ChrisRedmond100.
So what's the 100 bit? I mean, does that mean your name's very common and someone had taken like 1 through 99 and you had to become 100? Or is there a story? Knowing you, there's a story behind the 100.
I don't think there is an unusual.
Really?
Yeah, I think that years and years ago when I was trying to get C. Redmond or Redders or something like that, it suggests ChrisRedmond 100 or this number sequence. One of them was ChrisRedmond 100. And I think just because my memory isn't that great, I've always used ChrisRedmond 100. So, the thing for me that I love about social media that I've seen change actually over the last 5 years is I've always put a lot of content about me, my kids, my blogs are remarkably open about what I was going through at various stages in my life and at very turbulent points as well sometimes, really open. And some people have said, Chris, you need to be just a bit careful, but keep the lid on it. And I've never really believed in that because I am an all or nothing kind of guy. But nowadays, I actually think people aspire to be quite open as they possibly can be, so that people get that feeling of intimacy over a social channel. I think the dark embryonic days of where you sort of choose snippets of who you are to share are done. They're gone, especially among younger people. And I'd say I'm really open. And, sometimes that does attract some of the negativity and people passing their own comment. But whatever, that's part of the rules of the game now. You need to have a thick enough skin to wear it.
But also, Chris, people buy from people, right? So showing, the personal side or the man behind the face, the man behind the brand, it's like that gives you that warm and fuzzy feeling, right? About like, this is someone that's genuine. This is something that's real. It's someone that's there that I can relate to.
100%. Yeah, absolutely. I go back to that word authenticity. Colt, I was lucky enough at Colt. They put me through London Business School training. Called Rakesh Bazin, who was the chief executive. I have to mention him because Rakesh was definitely one of my mentors. And actually in one of the lectures that Rakesh maybe still delivers to LBS was all about authenticity. And maybe because of my relationship with him, I definitely took it on board that is part of the DNA. That's a chromosome that is intrinsic to who I am and will always be as a leader.
So Chris, just to wrap it up, right? It's like three things that I took away from this, right? Is authenticity. And that's a word that you need to put your teeth in for, but authenticity. If you're gonna do it, it's like make sure you get repeatable, it's like processes in place, like content is key. So that's the second thing. Content is key. Yeah. And then the third thing, what would you say the third thing is?
I think the third thing is being creative. You know, for me, if you wake up every day and you push yourself to be creative, you bring a streak of excitement to that day because you're making something. You know, I think we all like to build things as humans, whatever that is. And if you make something, it's something that you're putting into the world that's a reflection of yourself. And there's a feeling of satisfaction and gratification as well if what you create adds value to other people's businesses or lives.
Thanks, Chris. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the man. It's like a Chris Redmond from Redholt. Thanks very much, Chris. A pleasure. Thanks for having us. Thanks for joining us, Chris. It's a pleasure. Always good to talk to you, mate.
Likewise. Mutual feeling. Thank you, Colin.